Reverse by Black K Cat. Chapter 20. Volans. Despite all of Kurama's plans, Matatabi is nowhere to be found. It's frustrating, but more than that, it's worrying. Kurama wanders their shared mental world, even though he really doesn't want to run into any more of his siblings, searching for any trace of Cold Fire and Death Undone. There's nothing, though. Just emptiness where the cat's presence should be. Vaguely unsettled, Kurama leaps out over the water to settle on the little island Naruto once used, though he pointedly stays facing away from the Falls of Truth. There's no part of him that wants to meet his darker self because he knows exactly who and what that creature will be. Cold, malicious, calculating, wanting nothing more than to see Naruto's blood painting his hands and the world set alight for his pleasure alone. Even now, Kurama's not a pleasant person. For that matter, he's hardly even a person. Naruto reached down into him, changed him, made him better. But there are still pieces Naruto could never get to. It's not that Kurama regrets them, but maybe he wonders just a little what he'd be like if he had been able to save Naruto. If Kaguya had never stretched out her mad, grasping hands and torn the entire world from them. Still, he's not here to dwell. There's no point thinking about it because Kurama's already changed things here irrevocably and there's no way he's going to stop now. Steeling himself, he closes his eyes and stretches out his senses, trying to find Matatabi. Nothing. Just blankness, like something's been torn out and left a hole behind. Oh no. Kurama whispers, dragging his hands through his hair and fisting them on the red strands, yanking sharply. This is not good. Sage Matatabi, where are you? A simple lack of answer would mean that either Matatabi was pissed and ignoring him, or busy. A lack of presence. Well, Kurama really doesn't want to think what that means. He has to, though, can't not, and the only image currently coming to mind is Gaara. The older Gaara, laid out in that cave like a damn human sacrifice, unmoving, unbreathing, and... What if this is his fault? What if Matatabi's host, the host she likes, the host she's fond of, and Sage, it's making him think of his Naruto even more than he usually does? What if the girl was snatched by Akatsuki? Kakuzu was trying to collect Kokuo. After all, there's no way to say if they've decided to step up their timetable for gathering the Biju. If they have, the Nibi seems like a reasonable one to start with, given that the Ichibi's host is currently sacked out and drooling on Naruto's shoulder. Oh no. Kurama mutters again. If it is Akatsuki, if they've gotten to Matatabi, that's possibly the worst situation possible, barring another escape by Kaguya. It means all the Jinchuriki and Biju are in danger even more than they were before. This was always a possibility after Kurama interrupted Kakuzu's fight with Han. But Kurama honestly hadn't thought it was likely. For being a psychotic bastard, Obito is terrifyingly controlled, and he's better at long-term planning than almost anyone Kurama has met. As it stands now, Kurama can't imagine that he has anywhere even close to enough white Zetsu clones to stage another war, and he won't be able to stabilize them without Tenzo's Mogaton anyway. So why grab Matatabi if that's the case? Why put things in motion if there's no way to reach the goal yet? Unless Kurama is missing things, which is possible. He's not a mad Uchiha with illusions of godhood and world peace through mass hypnotism. At the Sage, but Madara must be a smooth bastard to sell a plan as messed up as that, even to a traumatized kid with seals all over his heart and the vision of his only friend's death on permanent technicolor repeat in his head. Still, regardless of flaws in the possible plan and a distinct lack of being able to think like a crazy Uchiha bastard, Kurama has to assume that it was Akatsuki who took Matatabi. Which means it's more than likely her host is dead and she's stuck inside that damn statue! If it turns out that something else is the cause of her going missing, Kurama will be pleasantly surprised, but for the moment he has to believe it was the absolute worst case scenario. It saved her for everyone that way. So, that leaves him with a choice. Keep heading north, hoping that Matatabi isn't actually sealed in the Ghetto Mazo, or that she appears in their shared world again, on the off chance that she's actually fine, or change direction. Which direction can he reasonably go, though? He's got not one, but three brats to look after, even if Fu seems mostly self-sufficient, and a sudden lack of any possible babysitters to take care of them while he goes and throws himself headlong at the Akatsuki. The Freak Squad is still on their tails, as is Kagazu, though Kurama's less worried about him. With a bit of control, Kurama could take him out. The 2.5 Sharingan users and the baby Mogotan user, though, they present a bigger problem. And that honestly does not say a hell of a lot about Kurama's chances against all of Akatsuki, even in their current reduced numbers. He has a plan, though. Sneak in, destroy the Genomazo, mess up Kaguya's plans to come back, and then sneak out again. He can pick the Akatsuki members off one at a time once there's no threat of them going through with the Eye of the Moon plan. Maybe even in pairs if he has to. That won't take too much effort, especially when he has no compunctions about killing them, unlike the Freak Squad. It's a good plan overall. Simple, straightforward, not too likely to make him get his butt kicked. Except, if Kakuzu has told them everything about him, about all the things he knows, it's likely Obito will be skulking around the base just on the off chance that Kurama ends up there. And that won't be good for anyone involved. Without the Jubi's powers, Obito will be a heck of a lot simpler to take down, but he's still an overpowered bastard with a particularly tricky Mugenkyo and almost 20 years of plotting in the shadows. It won't be an easy opponent, even if Kurama's not trying to save him from himself, the way Kakashi and Naruto were. Growling softly, Kurama shoves himself to his feet and takes a long bound back to the shore of the pool. He hates this! Why can't people just follow the neat lines that were all laid out for them before Kurama got back here? He's terrible at predicting what people are going to do because, appearances aside, he's not human! He's a Biju! A construction of chakra and malice that was dragged kicking and screaming out of the Shinju's form. No matter what Naruto was trying to do, shoving him into this damn body. No. No, he doesn't mean that because he knows exactly what Naruto sacrificed to bring him back and he will never take that for granted. He knows what the stakes are, what he's risking every time he sets a foot wrong. The fate of the world on his shoulders and all that, and it's an uneasy burden at the best of times for an ancient Biju still reeling from the traumatic death of his first and only friend. Still trying to pick his steps in a world where he's not a monster of mortal nightmare. End of the world aside, Naruto is depending on him. Both Narutos, his lost Jinchuriki and the little boy without a family, clinging to the first bit of kindness he's been shown. Gaara and Fu need him too, as startling and unnerving as that thought is. He's taken them on, taken responsibility for them, and he's not about to leave them stranded in the middle of the wilderness. So no matter what, this is a problem he has to solve. So, fine then. Options. Option 1. Head for Kumo anyway, because B might be a freak to outstrip the entire Freak Squad, but he's still a decent human being, no matter how much Kurama sometimes wants to tear out his tongue and shove it down his throat. Pros are possibly finding out what happened to Matatabi and her Jinchuriki. Cons are having the whole trip possibly be for nothing if B's off on one of his journeys, and the fact that A is a power grabber of epic proportions. There won't be much of a chance of getting the kids away if A realizes who they are, and he's too good a shinobi with too many connections regardless of the state of his politics for him to miss something like that. Option 2. Change course. Come up with somewhere else to stash the kids. Maybe one of his other siblings, though honestly that list is rapidly decreasing in length. Matatabi, Shukaku, the present Kyuubi, Chome, and Son are all out of the question. Isobu, because the Sanbei is squarely under Obito's thumb right now. Kokuo, too, by virtue of being both out of reach and previously targeted. That leaves Yuki, but option 1's not the best, and, well, Zaiken, pretty much. Crap, that's a short list, Kurama thinks despairingly. Still, it could be worse. Zaiken's weird and unnervingly cheerful all the time. And if Kurama didn't know better, he'd say the slug was permanently high. But in the brief time Naruto knew him, Utakata always seemed level-headed and fairly sensible. Of course, he's currently 10 years younger than he was when Naruto met him, which puts him at 15, maybe. Hopefully. Possibly 16, if Kurama's really lucky. And while Shinobi, and especially Jinchuriki, aren't exactly allowed to cling to childhood, that's still pretty young. It also has the added disadvantage of leaving Utagata still a dubiously loyal member of Kirigakure, because as far as Kurama remembers, the Rokubi's host didn't pack up and leave until he was 18. Which brings Kurama right back around to the fact that Kiri might as well be Obito's puppet state at the moment. There is possibly an option 3. Kurama can head them all in Kiri's direction, but also keep checking back in the Biju's shared mental world to see if Matatabi miraculously manages to answer. If not, he'll be close enough to Kiri to track down Saiken. If she does, he won't have gotten too far from Lightning Country's border, and changing course to Kumo won't be difficult. Of course, this means cutting right along the Fire Country border and then down through Hot Springs Country, which Kanaa Shinobi like to frequent. But it's still better than staying in one place and waiting for Taki, Suna, Kanaha, or the Akatsuki to catch up! And damn it all, but Kurama really needs to stop pissing off whole Shinobi villages and ridiculously powerful criminal organizations! This is getting annoying! At the moment, option 3 is just about the only viable course he could take. The kids need to be somewhere safe, and Kurama really needs to deal with Akatsuki, especially if they've already started grabbing Jinchuriki! Apparently, they're headed for Kiri then. With a sigh, Kurama slips out of the mental world, comes back to himself to find that there's a kick in his neck and a weight on his lap. He blinks, looking down, and can't fight a sudden smile at the sight of a blonde head resting against his chest, a red head on his thigh, and a green head nestled against his shoulder. All three of the kids have relocated themselves in their blankets, apparently deciding that Kurama is the best pillow available, and they're all fast asleep on top of him. A soft yipping laugh makes him look up, and his eyes land on Fuji, who's watching him with a distinct fox grin. Tongue lolling and ears pricked up. So cute, she teases lightly. Your kids are all so cuddly. Kurama might be annoyed, but he's pretty sure that these three have never in their lives gotten to be cuddly before. Maybe Fu, since she mentioned the mother earlier, but she also used past tense when referring to her. Safe for to assume that even if she has been treated as a kid, it was a long time in the past. Leave me alone. He tells the vixen, though it's hardly biting at all. They're tired, that's all. Fuji snorts softly, then lets the matter drop. Good news from your sister?
With a grimace, Kurama drags a hand through his hair. My sister's missing, he says shortly. Change of plans. We're going to have to head towards Hot Springs Country, take a boat from the tip, and make for Water Country. Something's happening, and I don't like it.
Fuji's ears tip back, flattening against her skull, and she rises, coming to press up against his free leg. I wish I had more tails, she huffs, sounding faintly miserable. Then I could fly us there in no time. I could try—
Not without killing yourself.
Kurama cuts her off. He scratches gently behind her ear, trying to comfort her.
Fuji, we've gotten us this far pretty much through your efforts alone. If you hadn't jumped in when you did, and then stuck around, we wouldn't have made it out of Fire Country.
Tapping her nose, he reminds her,
I still owe you that star ball, too.
With a disgruntled huff, Fuji flaps down alongside his leg, resting her chin on her paws. I want to be older, she complains. If Momiji were around! From the shadows cast by the shifting firelight, there's a long, low growl, and something stirs. In an instant, Kurama is on his feet, spilling children every which way with a growl of his own, rumbling through his chest, claws curled and ready even as his chakra rises like a fire. At his side, Fuji twists, flipping a leaf onto her head and instantly growling, rising to her feet the size of a small pony instead of a little fox. Right! An unfamiliar voice rumbles, and out of the darkness stalks a much bigger fox! Fur a deep silvery blue instead of Fuji's snowy white, with five tails and blue eyes and teeth bared in an angry snarl!
Go ahead, Fuji! Finish that sentence! I don't like this at all,
Roshi says grimly, surveying the interior of B's house. It looks a little like a whirlwind hit, or maybe the aftermath of an attack, but since they're on Turtle Island, surrounded by one of the strongest barriers Kumo's ever managed to come up with, Roshi has to assume that it wasn't foul play.
He must have left in a hurry, though, and that's definitely not a good sign where the state of things is concerned. Han makes a soft sound of agreement, shuffling through a pile of scrolls on the main table.
The Rey Kiri must have called him back very suddenly,
he confirms.
And if B actually went, it must have been for a reason that he thought was important, too.
Since there's not much that can make B worried outside of failing to come up with new raps,
the sinking feeling in Roshi's stomach just gets worse. He rubs a hand over his beard, all too aware of the tension of the Bijou sitting inside of him, who is distinctly unhappy with all of this, and can't help think of Kurama. The man is out there alone with just a fox summons and a pair of six-year-olds to help him, no matter how devoted they happen to be. He's grieving and hunted and lacking money and weapons and even decent clothes, and no matter how urgent it felt to head off after Han, Roshi is rather regretting his choice right about now. He should have stayed with Kurama, helped him get to Kumo. If he's been captured by A...
Stop fretting,
Han says with faint amusement, glancing up from his search.
You're about to give me ulcers.
Just for that, Roshi kicks him as hard as he can manage in the shin.
It is unfortunately just about the only place Roshi can reach without jumping because Han is an oversized idiot who didn't have the sense to realize he should have stopped growing once he passed 6 feet. Roshi is willing to admit that he's fairly short, especially for a man, but Han is just ridiculous. It's gratifying to see Han yelp and go stumbling backwards, and Roshi crosses his arms over his chest, satisfied with that reaction.
I'll stop fretting when you decide to take this seriously, he retorts sharply. B is gone. If someone took him forcibly, the barrier would be down and the animals would be in an uproar, so we don't have to worry about that. But if A called him back to Kumo and he went, it probably has something to do with Kurama. If there's any chance that we can help him, we should take it.
Even with the armor that covers the bottom of Han's face, Roshi can tell he's frowning.
We shouldn't jump to conclusions, he says calmly, though his tone is faintly warning. Roshi, we know nothing about Kurama. He saved my life, but it could be anyone.
Roshi frowns right back at him.
I don't care, he says flatly. Son and Goku will both agree he's related to them, and I don't give a damn if he's a Jinchuriki, a Bijou, or the fucking Sage of Six Powers reborn. You didn't see him with those kids, Han. I remember what it's like to be a child with a monster in your head, and the whole world set to hate you. Do you? Because he rescued those boys. He saved them, and he loves them. And that's not someone I'm going to let die, even if I have to burn every hidden village to the ground and make sure of it.
Han holds his gaze for a long moment before he looks away.
I remember,
he says softly, tucking his right hand into his haori.
It was very lonely.
Since Han is a good 10 years older than Roshi, they rarely crossed paths growing up, but Iwa isn't a safe place. If Han's childhood was anything like his, and all signs indicate that it was, even though it's one of the subjects they both avoid... That's the understatement of the century.
There are 9 of us, Roshi says, trying to keep his temper in check. 9 of us against a whole world that would spit on us sooner than look at us. A helped B, but he couldn't give a damn about the rest of us unless we swear ourselves to Kumo. Already, Kurama's done more for us than anyone. He warned us about Akatsuki, saved you, helped me face on, saved those kids. I don't care who he is on! He's one of us, he's helping! Even though no one else in all of existence cares about a handful of human containers beyond their potential as weapons. For that alone, I'd save him!
Another long stretch of silence, but Roshi knows his friend and lets it linger unbroken. Han is thinking hard, weighing all the options. That's what he does. Roshi is the impulsive, headstrong one. Han plans and hesitates and tries to keep out of danger as best he can. It's usually an amusing dichotomy given their appearances, but right now Roshi can't find it anything but grating. Finally, Han sighs, shifting his weight back slightly. He pulls his kasa off, tucking the hat under his arm and rubs a hand over his shorn hair.
I hope you have a plan,
he says a little wearily.
You're my best friend, Roshi, but I have no intention of dying alongside you if you're going to throw yourself headfirst at all the major villages.
Roshi, I'm bumps in indignation. I'm not an idiot, he reminds the big man sourly, even though he doesn't have more than the bare beginnings of a plan.
We need to find out where Kurama went, first of all.
I know he was heading for Kumo, but I have no idea if he made it there or got attacked along the way.
The Red Kage knows our faces,
Han points out.
And he knows what we are thanks to B. We can't risk heading straight there.
Kuruma mentioned that Konoha was after him, Roshi counters, even as the pieces fall together in his head. And I'm absolutely certain that A hasn't passed on what he knows about us to the village he considers his greatest enemy. There are sure to be patrols along Konoha's border. Pass ourselves off as bounty hunters after the price on Kurama's head, and they'll tell us what we need to know.
That might work,
Han says carefully, and Roshi magnanimously ignores the distinct note of doubt in his voice.
But Kumo also wouldn't share news of his capture, if they do have him.
That's true. Roshi considers the matter for a moment.
But Kurama's wandering around with Konoha's Jinchuriki and Tsunus. He's an arrogant bastard, but even he won't risk a war with Tsuna and Konoha by trying to keep their hosts.
Han concedes this with a nod and another faint sigh.
Alright, let's head south and find a border town. The odds of a Konoha patrol stopping to resupply are good, and it will be easier to find them there than track them through the wilderness.
I knew you'd see the light,
Roshi says, entirely satisfied.
Let's go. This place is a goddamn zoo without being here to keep the wildlife in check.
I'm surprised you want to leave, seeing how you fit right in. I decide.
Han says dryly, and Roshi promptly flips him off. Asshole. He accuses and storms out the door, entirely uncaring of the way it almost smacks Han in the face as the big man follows.
Hiruzen sits back in the shadows of the mission assignment office, pipe tapping absently against his lips, and watches Shikaku assign Shinobi to their tracking teams. Some of Konoha's best are in the room, standing in groups or pairs or already in teams. Even Tsume, Fugaku, and Hiyashi have turned up for the occasion, tucking quietly near the doorway. There are 10 teams, 30 of the very best trackers Konoha can offer, paired with 10 of Tsuna's best, and Hiruzen is grimly uncertain whether it will make any difference at all. He knows better than most just how dangerous a Jinchuriki can be, after all, and even beyond that, Uzumaki Kurama is an unknown. They can only speculate about his plans and motivations, and there's always the chance that they're incredibly wrong! Hiruzen is good at reading people, but his only encounter with Kurama lasted less than 5 minutes. Even he can't be expected to divine a man's character in that amount of time. Even so, it feels like a personal failing not having seen that Kurama was dangerous, on edge. That he was the kind of man who could steal not one child, but two, and drag them off into the wilderness. Hiruzen hasn't survived this long as a Kage without learning how to lay blame on those actually responsible rather than keeping it all for himself. But this is Naruto. This is Minato's son. Hiruzen's honorary grandson. There's no applying logic when family is at risk.
How many villages have accepted so far?
The man beside him asks in a low voice, dark eyes flickering over the assembled shinobi. Hiruzen doesn't look at the Yondaime Kazekage because he doesn't need to see the deep lines of worry and grim resignation that match his own etched into the other Kage's face. The man had arrived this morning with a full contingent of shinobi armed for war, though thankfully not a war against Konoha. Despite the strained relations between their villages, they're still nominally allies, and the Kazekage had proposed adding some of his own trackers to the teams Hiruzen planned to send out. It's a gesture that Hiruzen even now finds surprising, though perhaps he shouldn't. The Kazekage is still a father, even if he's one who was forced to choose between the life of his child and the safety of his village.
Saki and Iwa, he answers, though they don't hold any biju themselves, you and Ame have given us permission to enter their lands, as has Rice Paddy Country and Wave Country. Tani as well, though we're fairly certain Kurama is moving east, not west. I've yet to hear back from Kumo, though I hope A will be sensible, given that his brother is one of the Jinchuriki at risk.
Nakase Kage grunts in acknowledgement, looking far older than his actual years. He drags a hand over his spiky auburn hair, mouth pulling into a tight line.
No word on which Jinchuriki this bastard has managed to grab.
Hiruzen shakes his head, taking a long drag on his pipe and then breathing out a gusty cloud of smoke.
Iwa is hedging. I assume that means they either can't locate their Jinchuriki right now, or they haven't been able to in a while. It wouldn't be the first time hosts abandon the village. Taki is under the impression that their container ran away, as she seems to do frequently, and that it has nothing to do with Kurama. But I find it rather hard to believe in such coincidental timing.
That earns him a grimly amused snort.
No village wants to admit that they've misplaced a tailed beast.
I agree with you, though. This bastard knew exactly what he was doing when he took my son. He never hesitated. And I find it suspicious that he's taking the youngest in Cherokee first. They're more malleable, more prone to believing whatever lies he's spinning for them.
Deliberately. Hiruzen doesn't mention that those lies, whatever they might be, would be a lot less believable if the Jinchuriki were treated with basic human decency. After all, his house is very much made of glass in this matter, and he's not about to start throwing stones. No matter how he's trying to be close to Naruto, he's Okage. He barely has time for his son, his daughter, and his grandson, let alone any other family. For over 40 years now, Hiruzen has been putting the welfare of Konoha above the well-being of any one person in it, even when that one happens to be a boy he loves dearly. Instead, he simply sighs and casts his eyes to where a fiercely grinning Sume is lounging next to a stiff and quietly offended Fugaku. The Inuzuka and Uchiha clan heads aren't exactly the closest of friends, but since no one's throwing punches, he's going to assume things are going better than they usually do. Thankfully, Shibi is currently on the other side of the room dealing with Shukaku. The Aburame clan head might look aloof and withdrawn, but he has a tendency to be very protective of Sume, despite the fact that she most certainly doesn't need it. It tends to be especially noticeable where Fugaku is concerned, because Fugaku has certain notions about Konohichi and propriety, and Sume has made a sport of flaunting such things wherever possible. Sometimes Hiruzen feels more like an exasperated schoolteacher than the leader of the most powerful Inuit village. He wonders, with a faint quirk of his lips, if the Kazekage ever feels the same way. He's not really in the mood to be amused right now, though. Things are rapidly spiraling out of control, and he greatly dislikes the fact that Iwa can't seem to locate their Jinchuriki. It makes Hiruzen wonder if Konoha wasn't actually Kurama's first stop. After all, Naruto and Gaara were both young enough that Kurama was more or less forced to come and collect them. The other Jinchuriki were more than capable of moving on their own, and if they had left Iwa already, there would be no one to notice. Hiruma doesn't even know their faces or anything about their abilities, and that's a dangerous situation to be in if they're potentially hostile. This whole matter is a headache and a half, even without the added joy of having to cooperate with all of the other villages. The mere thought of all the politics that will be involved as Hiruzen contemplating whether there's any way at all he can trick Jiraiya into returning and taking the hat. Heaven knows, Hiruzen doesn't want it.
It's going to be a heck of a long week,
the Kazekage says wearily, as if reading Hiruzen's mind. More likely is the fact that those kinds of thoughts are inescapable for a man in their position.
So let's do our best to make it as short a manhunt as possible.
Hiruzen agrees and puts his pipe aside as he rises to his feet. That's enough of a break, no matter how his battered old bones complain. There are matters to be attended to, messages to deliver, teams to dispatch. Hiruzen is old, but he's not dead yet, and he's lived through three very long wars. He's bound and determined to see that there won't be a fourth.